Any Americans in Corazon? I think I asked that. I'm asking it again.
Look, Guy's point is very important. We hit Corazon because we got a right to hit Al-Qaeda. That gave us the right to hit Syria. What it tells you is Congress has got to come back here in December, and they're going to have to vote for a new authorization for this war. You can't use these subterfuges for
Corazon is the fig leaf for Congress?
Corazon was the fig leaf to get our strikes into Syria.
Right, and it's the fig leaf for Congress to take some action that has been requested by the president.
They got to get something new for all this bombing we're doing in Syria.
Corazon was not a fig leaf because if you have evidence that your national security is at stake and there's an imminent attack, the president had every right to do that. Look, John Boehner, the speaker, just said no vote. So, let's see what Congress does.
They're not going to vote.
They don't know how which way the politics are going to go, and they're scared to vote. So
exactly, they're are
we finished with sovereign airspace? Sovereignty being, according to Kissinger's latest book, where he derives so much, where he attaches so much importance to sovereignty.
The sovereign lines have been covered as far as we can.
They need a new authorization to continue bombing Syria that is not Corazon. We got no right to bomb that country.
We have no clearance to bomb Syria, and sovereignty dictates we should not bomb Syria. Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying unless Congress basically authorizes a war inside Syria.
Why didn't Obama call him up?
Call who up?
They're on vacation. They're out campaigning.
He doesn't
want to. They're not going to come back, and he's not going to, unless he knows that he's going to get support. What kind of signal does it send to the world if they don't step up? I think they will.
The 2001 authorization military force.
So he doesn't have to go to them, and I think it's a good thing if the Congress and the executive. It's a good thing if the Congress and the executive do go together, but it's not essential. And
you mean he can fight
it's up to the Congress.
He can fight a presidential war, you're telling me? Another presidential war?
I don't know what your point is.
We will live in mystery.
We're going to live in mystery on that. Issue two, a Bush is back.
Republicans can show that they lead if they gain a majority status. So I am working as hard as I can to help candidates when they've asked for it.
Former Florida Governor Jeb Bush stumped for North Carolina Senate candidate Republican Tom Tillis this week in one of the most closely watched races in the country. Mr. Tillis is in a tight contest with sitting Senator Democrat Kay Hagan. So Tillis has been calling on Republican heavyweights to lend their support. At the event, Jeb Bush expounded on issues that he is fervent about. One, immigration reform. He's a proponent of a pathway to citizenship for illegal immigrants. And two, education standards, the Common Core, disliked by GOP activists. The New York Times noted that candidate Tillis, quote, gently put distance between himself and his guest of honor, unquote, on these issues, and voiced far more conservative stances on immigration and education than did Mr. Bush.
Question, if Jeb Bush decides to run for president in 2016, is he too moderate for the Republican base, or is he just what the doctor ordered? Pat.
It's too moderate for the Republican base. You take Common Core. Bobby Jindal was very much out in favor of it. Bobby Jindal, the governor of Louisiana, he's had to run away from that. Marco Rubio was for immigration
reform. Marco Rubio?
Marco Rubio is the U.S. Senator from Florida who was thinking about damaged deeply by his support for immigration reform. He's run away from it. Jeb Bush, first, John, he doesn't look to me like he's got the fire in the belly. He hasn't run in a dozen years or more for anything.
Well, he's
got
getting these two, warmed up.
As these two issues will see him torn apart in a very rough primaries and caucuses,
to his credit, Iowa and
New Hampshire.
To his credit, he's not walking away from those issues like the other two people you cited.
He's not
running away. He's doubling down on immigration reform. He's doubling down on the Common Core. And if you look at the field, other than, I suppose, Chris Christie, it's a field that's filled with conservatives and social conservatives and libertarians. So you can imagine that he could carve out a piece in that landscape. And I think it would be refreshing if you had someone who actually is saying what they think and isn't backing away from earlier positions. Mm-hmm. He may be in the wrong party, though.
Are you against posturing?
I'm for posturing for a good cause.
Are you?
But the Republican nomination
progress,
is not necessarily that good a cause.
What do you think of Jeb?
You know, I met him, I've met him before, but I met him for a good period of time a number of weeks ago when he came to New York, and he had a very small luncheon. And I will tell you, he was as knowledgeable and as effective and as thoughtful as any Republican that I have talked to in a very, very long time. I think he's absolutely first rate. He's a real talent, and he speaks with authority. He's not overwhelming in any sense. He's going to be a very effective candidate if he comes in. But he also, as you know, speaks perfect Spanish. So this is going to be something that's going to be helping with at least the Hispanic community. I think he is going to be, in my judgment, the leading candidate for the Republican nomination. I'm not saying he's going to win it. I think he is by far the most outstanding candidate to have and the one who has the best chance to win a presidential election. And the conservatives in the Republican Party, if they aren't careful, they do not want to be in the wilderness for another 8 years after the Obama presidency. And they know they need a leader who can be elected, and he can be elected.
Did he take questions from the floor?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Was he asked whether or not he was going to run?
Well, of course he was asked whether or not
he
was
going to run. What
did he say? Mort, the national polls have not been good for Jeb Bush.
Well, hold on. I want to hear what he said. What did he say?
He said he hasn't made up his mind yet.
He hasn't made up his mind.
No.
His mother said, we've had enough Bushes in the White House. His mother said that.
John, his mother may have said that. You don't travel all the way to New York, for example, to have lunch with 10 or 15 people unless you're interested somehow or other in your political future. So I have no idea whether he's going to run or not.
I suspect he is going to run.
I agree with everything all three of you said, and I appreciate Mort's zeal, but frankly, I don't know who Jeb Bush thinks he is at this point.
Jeb.
Okay, he's going to be running. There's only so much room for rational, middle-of-the-road, honest Republicans in this upcoming race, okay? And the space is filled both physically
Jeb clears that hurdle, don't you?
Physically and ideologically by Chris Christie. Okay, Jeb Bush will put him on a stage with Christie. Christie will blow him away. Jeb Bush, he hasn't run for anything since 2002.
Romney and Bush, I think, have some kind of deal. I think they've got some kind of deal. If one goes, the other doesn't, because they would split up the moderate vote in the Republican
Romney. A former senator.
Between
Romney, Christie, and Jeb Bush.
I put more odds that Romney gets in than that Bush gets in. But I haven't talked to either. Talk to them at lunch.
Exit question. Is the GOP ready for a third Bush candidacy? Yes or no? Pat Buchanan.
It may be, but I don't think
candidacy.
So. I mean, for his running? Look, he's got a perfect right to run, and I think there's a chance he will, but I think it's more likely Romney will run, and more likely maybe that Christie will run.
No fire in the belly.
I don't think doesn't show me the fire in the belly.
Americans have a short attention span, and they're forgiving, so I think if he gets in the race, he's got a chance.
I hope he runs. He'll get chewed apart by the crazy right wing in the primaries if he does, though. He absolutely will.
I don't agree with that. As I say, I think if they do that, okay, they're going to be in the wilderness again forever. They're not that, I was going to say, they're not that stupid. They're not that unwise, is a better way to put it. They don't want to be in the wilderness after Obama administration. If you have an Obama administration and then a Clinton administration, and you're a conservative Republican,
you're going to compete against Hillary
Clinton. Jeb Bush's gubernatorial career in Florida was a masterpiece.
Yes, it was excellent.
And he's totally beloved by the people there.
Yes.
He got that state through a horrible hurricane.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And his governing and the fact that he has an Hispanic wife and that whole aspect of it have a lot to bear in his what he brings to the picture. Issue 3, is the science settled?
This is not fiction. It is science. Unchecked, climate change will pose unacceptable risks to our security, our economies, and our planet.
Let me just set the stage by saying that the science here is settled.
These words on climate change were uttered by President Obama at the Copenhagen Climate Conference 5 years ago and at a town hall meeting 4 months ago. This week at the United Nations General Assembly in New York, more than 120 world leaders met against the background of mass marches to call attention to the need for an international climate change treaty when delegates meet in Paris next year. President Obama says the scientific debate on climate change is settled, but not everyone concurs. In an important dissent, the Obama administration's own former Undersecretary for Science in the U.S. Energy Department, Dr. Stephen Koonin, called Mr. Obama's claim that the science is settled, quote-unquote, misguided. Dr. Koonin says the claim chills scientific inquiry and inhibits a much-needed examination of why the computer models climate scientists rely on are consistently wrong. Item, missing ice. Computers accurately forecast shrinkage in the Arctic sea ice, but completely miss the record growth in the Antarctic sea ice. Item, missing heat. The models predict a hotspot developing in the tropics, but no such hotspot exists. Item, more missing heat. The models miss the fact that for 16 years now, temperatures have not risen, despite a 25% jump in global carbon emissions. Item, missing carbon. The models cannot explain why 70 years ago, when carbon emissions were far lower, sea levels rose by 1 foot per century, the same rate as today when carbon emissions are ubiquitous. Dr. Koonin says climate change is real, and man plays a part. But, quote, while the past two decades have seen progress in climate science, the field is not yet mature enough to usefully answer the difficult and important questions being asked of it. Any serious discussion must begin by acknowledging not only the scientific certainties, but also the uncertainties, especially in projecting the future, unquote.
Is the science truly settled? Guy Taylor.
John, I read the Koonin piece, and I thought it made some very good arguments, but I think we have to ask ourselves, despite this guy's past relationship with the Obama administration, he's now in the private sector, and is he a shill for the oil company?
Well,
and essentially,
that's lovely.
The oil company is essentially the fossil fuels lobby. I want to seize on it, though, and point something out. The debate about whether or not the science is settled is going to go on for a while. What we should be looking at in any segment on this is the fact that people on both sides of the debate can agree that air pollution around the world, in American cities, but especially in the Far East, Beijing, Jakarta, these places, it's horrific. This is something that can be explained all the way down to mothers of children, regardless of where they sit on the intellectual, education, socioeconomic scale.
Helena.
Well, climate change is real and it's happening, and now you see both sides trying to lower the rhetoric and say, let's now just try to address the changes. It may be too late to reverse the warming of the planet that is already underway, but we can do something to help the Pacific Island nations, which are beginning to drown. California, Florida, New York, coastal cities are all taking action to prepare for what's ahead. I don't understand why conservatives have turned this into such an ideological mission. It's clear that the pollution that we're putting into the atmosphere is not helping. It's not helping the oceans.
Because
it's not helping anything.
Let me talk to the conservatives. Look, there's no doubt we can measure things scientifically, how warm it is. And global warming stopped in about 97. We can measure that. You can measure the size of the Arctic ice pack and Antarctic ice pack. What they can't do, John, the science is predictable. This is unpredictable. We've had things.
Okay.
They haven't predicted anything right. And in all these areas, what they're trying to do is transfer wealth and power from people and nations to global bureaucrats.
Jeb Bush will run for president in 2016. Yes or no?
1 in 3 chances.
Looks like a yes.
I would say no.
Yes.
The answer is yes. Bye-bye.